Windows shortcuts. We've all seen them, we've all used them, but they have a secret and are a little bit more interesting than most people realize. But by the end of this video, you will be a super expert and can brag to all your friends about knowing so much more about them. First of all, let's get this secret out of the way because I know a lot of you are thinking, wait a second, a shortcut just points to another target location with a few other options like a starting directory and whether to run it as administrator. It's probably just some basic plain text format, right? But actually, no. In reality, shortcuts are actually binary files. And while you may have noticed that the shortcuts apparently have no file extension, even if you enable the option in Windows to show file extensions, shortcuts do actually use a super hidden LNK extension. I say super hidden because you can make Windows show the link extension, but it requires deleting a specific registry entry called never show extension under the hkey classes root link file location. I personally do still keep them hidden though. Of course, I do have file extensions enabled for all other files. So what exactly is inside a shortcut link file then? Well, like I said, there is quite a bit more to them than meets the eye, and knowing how they work behind the scenes might come in handy. In a minute, I'll give a specific example involving a cool trick with pinning stuff to the start menu and taskbar. Before that though, speaking of something else that's cool, is today's sponsor, Ugreen, and two of their products, the Ugreen 145 watt power bank and Ugreen Nexode 100 watt charger. The power bank is an absolute unit with a capacity of 25,000 milliamp hours, and thanks to the latest power delivery 3.1 and quick charge 3.0 technologies, it can output a total of up to 145 watts simultaneously, depending on the device count, or up to 140 watts from a single port. That's enough to charge a MacBook Pro 16-inch to 56% in just 30 minutes. You can also fast charge up to three devices at once using the two USB-C and one USB-A ports, or even simultaneously charge the power bank while you charge two other devices. It also has other cool features, such as a digital display showing the current charge level, and an optional trickle charging feature activated by holding the side button for 3 seconds. This lets you lower the output if you don't need the device's maximum charging speed, which can save on heat and potentially battery life over time. As for the Ugreen Nexode 100 watt charger, it boasts a compact size even with that high output power. It can fast charge up to four devices simultaneously with the three USB-C and one USB-A ports, and yes, it is capable of outputting the full 100 watts from a single port, assuming the device supports it. And that is enough to charge a MacBook Air M2 to 55% in less than 30 minutes, for example. So be sure to check out the links in the description to learn more, and also check out Ugreen's Prime Day deals for big savings of up to 41% off. And with all that being said, let's continue. All right, so the first thing you'll notice if you try to actually look inside a shortcut file is that they're not actually easy to open in the first place. For example, if you try to open one with Notepad, it's not going to open the shortcut link file itself, but rather whatever it's pointing to, which is what anyone would expect, to be fair. A lot of times you can actually get around this though by launching it via the command prompt and then specifying the exact link file like this. But you'll notice that there's not really much to see, because again, it's a binary file and therefore contains machine code, nothing human readable. However, that doesn't mean we can't see what's going on inside. It just means we need some special tools. Now, I'm not gonna go into the literal byte-by-byte structure of link files. Microsoft does have a whole 48-page document about the link file format if you wanted to write your own tool from scratch or something for it. But fortunately, there are plenty of tools for analyzing shortcut files that other people have made already. The most capable one I've found, which is also free, is called LECmd, created by a guy named Eric Zimmerman, who also has many other popular security and forensic software tools available on his website. You don't even need to install it, you just open the command prompt to the directory with the tool, do LECmd-f, and then the path to the shortcut. And there are other options you can set through different arguments. Anyway, the output might look pretty overwhelming, but we can ignore most of it. There are only a few parts that I'm gonna focus on, especially the last part called the property store. But again, don't worry if this seems technical right now. You don't actually have to memorize any of this. It's just gonna help understand it. For one example, let's take a look at a shortcut that I copied from the start menu to a program called Descript. And what I'll do is look at the shortcut properties and then copy the target box and manually create a new shortcut with that same target path that I just copied. Now, when looking at the properties windows for these two, they look identical, but actually they're not behind the scenes. If we run LECmd on both and then look at their property store, you can see that the original automatically created shortcut actually refers to the app ID of the app, while the one that I created manually just has the path. And the fact that there's these different types of references and shortcuts behind the scenes that don't seem to be any different on the surface is good to know in certain specific situations. For one real life example, say you have a shortcut to a pinned program in the start menu. Like you went and did right click on the desktop icon and hit pin to start. Then say you want to pin a second shortcut to that same program, but with a different set of launch parameters or arguments. Like maybe you want a separate shortcut to launch Chrome with different settings using different arguments, for example. But if I were to just make a copy of Chrome's desktop shortcut and then add some arguments to it and then try to right click and hit pin to start with that second new one, it won't let me. It just says unpin from start, as if it's already pinned, but it's not, it's a different one. But here's the trick. If I instead right-click on the desktop and create a new shortcut, then copy in the exact same path and arguments as what appeared before, now it does indeed let me pin this new shortcut to the start menu. And I have both here. So what gives? Why did it let me do it this time? Well, it turns out that the start menu tries to avoid allowing multiple pins to the same program, and also realize that the original shortcut that we pinned happened to be of the app ID type. And for whatever reason I've discovered, the start menu ignores arguments on the app ID type shortcuts. And that's whether there's only one of them to a program or you try to make multiple. And the reason the second shortcut showed up and worked when we created it via the new shortcut method was because that created a path type shortcut. And the start menu does see arguments on those kinds. So it considered it a different link. Though if you have a path type with no arguments, it will still consider that a duplicate of the app ID one. So if you've ever tried to pin something to the start menu using arguments and it didn't seem to apply them, well, try unpinning it, recreating the shortcut, and then pinning that new version, and it'll probably work. And the same goes if you try to create a second shortcut with arguments, as you saw. Now, unfortunately, the taskbar is a different story. It apparently doesn't let you add multiple of the same items, even if there are different types of shortcuts or if they have different arguments. And unfortunately, you can't simply add a shortcut to the special folder that contains the pinned taskbar shortcuts either, since it turns out that the actual list of pinned items for the taskbar is stored in some registry key in the binary format, so you can't just go and edit that either. But I did figure out a pretty dumb workaround that actually works. What you do is create a shortcut to some random app that you don't want to pin, like the command prompt. However, you want to name this shortcut whatever you're gonna wanna name the actual thing you're gonna end up pinning, like maybe Chrome with args. It doesn't really matter, you'll see what I mean. And then right-click and pin that new shortcut to the taskbar. So right now, you'll just have a random shortcut to the command prompt in the taskbar. We're not done. Next, go into the folder that has the pinned taskbar icons, it's at this path, and delete that shortcut that we just created, and then replace it with a shortcut of the same name, except this shortcut is the actual shortcut that you want to link to. So this actually goes to Chrome with those arguments. And then voila, the new shortcut goes where you want, and the arguments are included. And after restarting Explorer, even the icon will be updated. That's because the registry entry for the taskbar pinned items knows that there's a shortcut by that name, but it doesn't know where it goes to. That's actually stored in the shortcut file, so we're just kind of like tricking it. Just be aware that the program path that you used in that original placeholder shortcut has to be unique, because that original path will still be stored in the registry key as a backup, so you can't use the same placeholder file for more than one at a time because it'll think it's a duplicate. Okay, anyway, next let's take a look at something else that's interesting. By now, you've probably heard of that famous GodMode folder in Windows, where if you create a folder with a certain name, it opens up this special folder containing direct links to a whole bunch of different settings, almost everyone imaginable in Windows. Now, that folder is not actually a shortcut, so let's instead take a look at the stuff inside, which are links. For a random example, we can take a look at the Change Mouse Settings shortcut, which just opens the mouse settings. If we right-click it, we can create a shortcut to it that will go to the desktop. But what will that shortcut actually go to? If we just look at the properties window for it, it's not very helpful. The target and target type literally just say change the mouse pointer display or speed. But if we use LECmd on it again, we can see something interesting. It looks like the actual path is some kind of command, which says microsoft.mouse/2. And I found an article from Microsoft explaining a bit about this called Canonical Names of Control Panel Items, which describes what this is and other similar things. You can see that this command has corresponding info, like its unique GUID it's called, the module path, and even some numbers for the pages in each menu. Like in this case, the 2 is the pointer options. Though not every shortcut in the God Mode folder is like this. Like if we look at other ones under troubleshooting, such as find and fix problems with Windows search, that one actually goes to an exe called msdt.exe with some parameters. Though believe it or not, all those links in the God Mode folder are not everything. Windows has a whole bunch of so-called shell folders, which a lot of times are either a special virtual folder, it's not really a folder, but it's like goes to some menu or something, or it might be just an alias for an actual folder location. Someone actually posted an article with a complete list of all these, which I can link to in the description. And these can be a code or name, again, given to a special path specifically, such as the startup programs folder, which is shell:startup, or something like virtual folders like the libraries folder. Other types of these shell folders don't have an actual name, but are rather referenced with the CLS ID it's called, which is this thing between the brackets. One example is this add network location menu, which uses this command. Many of these seem to be menus as opposed to folders, but not all of them. And some appear to be in both lists, such as the libraries folder, which can also be accessed via this other command. These commands can be used in a couple ways. If you want to create a shortcut, you can just copy any command in its entirety and put that in the target, like explore and then whatever shell thing. And then you can also run this in the run box or even through the command prompt. Alternatively, you can just paste the shell part of the command right into the path bar in Windows Explorer like this. Though I was feeling a bit ambitious, so with the help of some AI tools, I created a PowerShell script that basically goes through all of these and creates a sort of super God Mode folder with all of these shortcuts, but also goes through and fetches their proper icons if available and the names. And it actually pulls from everything in the registry, not like a static list. So it should always remain up to date in the future, at least for a while. I'll put a link to that script in the description if you want to check it out, along with some instructions on how to run it at the top of the script you can read. So now at this point, I think you can all consider yourselves experts of Windows shortcuts. You can even put that on your resume and brag to all your friends. Also, let me know down in the comments though, if you have any neat tips that maybe I didn't mention or might've missed. I'm sure there's a lot more that we can learn. Also, thanks again to Ugreen for sponsoring. Check out the Ugreen Nexode 100-watt charger and 145-watt power bank with links in the description. And also check out Ugreen's Prime Day deals up to 41% off. If you're interested, next up, I would really recommend you watch one of my other videos where I talked about symbolic links in Windows, they're called, which are basically like super shortcuts and incredibly useful. I'll put a link to that right there you can click on. So thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.